How are you, everybody who is watching this video? I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all the local, national, and international students into this moment of learning the beauty of advanced chemistry. My name is Olenjola Mogotayai Losingo. Simply just can call me Olenjola. I thank God by his own gift of teaching. I'll be teaching you the beauty of advanced chemistry in this session, but also in our online school, I'll be teaching you some other subjects for the Form 5 and the Form 6 students. So at this moment, I would like just to welcome all the pre-Form 5 students, pre-Form 6 students, Form 5 students, Form 6 students, grade 12 students, and advanced secondary students, even teachers who are teaching advanced chemistry or advanced physics. You're warmly welcome into this moment when we are going to share and we are going to receive a good news and get the answer of some of the questions that you've been asking yourself. So I would like to take just a few minutes to talk about the topic that we are going to learn. Organic chemistry, I would like just to say it's the heart of entire advanced chemistry from 5 and from 6. It has been a very important topic, and actually that it will be becoming more important as you go higher and higher with advanced chemistry, especially when we'll be focusing in different engineering aspects of the chemicals, or in different aspects of the earth, or in different aspects of the allied science. So whenever that we'll be dealing with earth science, we'll be dealing with organic. When we'll be dealing with allied science, we'll be dealing with organic. When we'll be dealing with health science, we'll be dealing with organic. And we'll be dealing with maybe laboratory science, we'll be dealing with organic. And even if you'll be dealing with chemical engineering or some different fields of chemical engineering or processing engineering, you'll be dealing with organic. So that's why I say that it's the heart of advanced chemistry. So because the heart of advanced chemistry, I would like to encourage and insist students to be serious and learn these contents not only for the advanced level, but you have to learn these contents even for your further studies after your advanced educations. Again, I'd like to remind you the vision that we have in Tanzania Online Advanced Secondary School in Square Bracket College of IM, because the word of God say in the book of Proverbs 29 verse 18, it said that where there's no vision, people perish. So if you don't have vision, we don't know the destinations, and we don't know also the legacy that we have to leave, the programs is going to perish, and even ourselves are going to perish, and even our students also are going to perish. So I'd like to remind you quickly, and then we'll go into the session 20, which I've prepared for you. And this is the vision that we have in our mind, that we have an assignment to teach and train advanced secondary students on how to extract knowledge, understanding, and wisdom from the classroom instructions, and combine it with knowledge and wisdom from the Word of God that we'll be teaching them to extract it in order to solve real-life problems. So the main objective of this program is to teach our students to think outside the box and solve the real-life problems that exist in our community by using the knowledge, understanding, and wisdom from those two areas or aspects of life. So as well as we are learning advanced chemistry, and also you can learn the Word of God, as well as you are learning advanced physics, also you can take time and learn the Word of God. As well as you are learning advanced physics, the time you're investing, the energy you're investing, if you'll be investing proportionally also in the Word of God, then you'll get something which is actual, exceptional, and unique. So when I'll be saying, or when I'm telling you that I'll be dealing with students who would like to solve their real life problems, I'm not talking to all students, but I'll be talking with few students who are ready prepared and who are ready to take a cost or to pay for the cost, because actually it's expensive to think outside of the box, because the inside the box you'll be thinking about doing an exam, passing for the exam, giving a certificate, going to the higher education, then you graduate, you'll be given a certificate, you'll be employed somewhere else, you'll be paid a salary, then you enjoy the life. That's what we call the inside the box. But if you want to think outside the box, there's an extra cost you have to pay. And it doesn't mean that the cost of money, first of all, the cost of your mindset has to change, and the cost of your mindset have to think differently. And sometimes you are responsible to think success after 10 years from the time when you are solving that real life problems. If you'll be focusing on the fruits of a month, within a month, my dear, I want to tell you that you are still thinking inside the box. So if you, that's what I'm telling you, that there's a cost for these programs of to achieve the main objective of this program. But our specific objectives, some of them, that's what we'll be preparing you for your continuing assessment, we'll be preparing you for your mock exams, we'll be preparing you for your NECT exams. So we'll be doing at least everything that you are looking for in order to free your mind from those things which have been holding you and even have been holding generations after generations. Again, in case that you want to interact with me, please use the comment section below and to ask you questions as long as we go about these sessions, and even the next sessions you may use that platform in order to interact with me. If you are new students, or you are not a new student but you have never registered yourself, then I ask you that to check the next part that will give you the information how you can register yourself. Alright, so I'll let take this opportunity to welcome you again into our online school that called Tanzania Online Advanced Secondary School in Skyrocket Olenjulai M. And welcome into our official YouTube channel that called Tanzania Online A-Level Secondary School in Skyrocket Olenjulai M. So this is Departments of Advanced Chemistry, the subject Advanced Chemistry, and the main topic is theory, it's called Advanced Organic Chemistry. So these contents we dedicate to pre-form 5 or form 5 students or recitors or QT or grade 12 or teachers and the what physicists. So we are in chapter 2 in case of advanced organic chemistry. This is called saturated and unsaturated hydrocarbons. And this is session 20, which is titled as chemical reactions of alkenes. In session 19, so this is quick review. Quick review of session 19. So the quick review of session 19, first of all, it is being titled as laboratory preparation. So laboratory preparation of alkenes. And I've told you three methods of laboratory preparation for alkenes, but before teaching you, we say that first of all, all of these laboratory preparations of alkenes, we define them in chemistry as elimination chemical reaction. So we are eliminating something from the organic compound. Elimination chemical reaction. So elimination chemical reaction. And then as we say that these elimination chemical reactions are guided by Zaitsev's rule. Yeah? Zaitsev's rule. Zaitsev's rule, which state that during what?
During elimination reaction.
Elimination reactions. Then what will happen?
The
hydrogen atom is eliminated from what?
Carbon with
fuel number of 40. So we say that we have three common methods that we can prepare alkenes in the laboratory. The first one is called the halogenation, of alkyl halide, right?
Yes.
The halogenation of alkyl halide. And you find what the mix of the halogenation. Then the other ones is called the dehydration. So dehydration sulfate of alcohol. And we define the meaning of dehydration chemical reaction. And then the other method, we say that we can prepare alkene by heating what vicinal compounds. And they left you some homeworks that you have to do or you have to complete by using the chemical reactions, or by using what mechanisms. You have to complete them by using mechanisms. So in case that you have missed it, or maybe you have not gone through session 19, you can access that this time in our official YouTube channel that called Tanzania Online A Level Secondary School in Square Bracket for the July M. So I mean that you can take advantage of that in order to go into much details. Okay, again, if you did your homework and then you are wondering how you can submit, just submit in the comment section below there. So today, let us focus on chemical reactions of food alkenes. So let us get into today's session. Chemical reactions of alkenes. Chemical reactions of alkenes. So let us start with the sentence that alkenes are more reactive. Alkenes are more reactive organic compounds. And they can undergo so many chemical reactions compared to alkali. At the first sentence. So again, we say that the chemical reactions of alkenes depends on the reactivity of the pi bonds. So we say that, let me put this one. Alkenes have double bond between carbon atoms, whereby one bond is sigma bond, and the second bond is pi bond. One bond is sigma bond, and the other one is pi bond. So I say that the reactivity of pi bond. The pi bond is localized between
identical atom to an identical atom. So this pi bond is localized, not delocalized. Localized pi bond. So what does it mean? So listen. For example, you can have a bond, double bond between carbon atoms like this. And then maybe you can have a single bond like this. If the bond is localized, listen carefully. It means that if I number this is carbon one and this is the second carbon, like this, then for example that, yeah, okay, so number one, number two, number three. If the bond, the pi bond, or the double bonds, just you get the pi bond because the one that can be localized or delocalized. If it is localized, it means always, if you examine this bond, or maybe for example use electronic microscope to check this bond, we'll find a pi bond existing between the first carbon and second carbon. Right? If it's localized. If it is delocalized, it means that we can examine this double bond, and then so we find that just this is the first carbon, this is the second carbon, this is the second carbon. So we can examine it within a second and find the double bond or the pi bond between first carbon and second carbon. And then within a short time or within a second again can find this double bond is localized to exist between the second carbon and third carbon. Then after a short time, so you find these bonds has been delocalized to exist the pi bond between first carbon and second carbon. Then after a short time, then you find these pi bonds is delocalized to exist between the second carbon and third carbon. So that the meanings of delocalization. Say delocalization. So delocalization means that the pi bond is not localized, is not fixed between the two atoms, but it is shifting. It means that the bonds is not existing, or it's not permanently in one place, or it's not permanently between the two identical atoms, but the bonds is shifting to the nearby or the adjacent carbons. And we'll find this property of delocalizations when I'll be teaching you about aromatic organic compounds, and especially in benzene, right? So you find that tendency of what delocalization. So delocalizations means that the bond is not stationary. So the bonds, actually it's not moving, but it's changing its position, right? So this is very important. Whenever you find mat, it means that what double bond or triple bond, you have to think also about localizations. It's just like in case even non-pair, because also there are some tendencies of delocalizations of pi bonds due to the lone pair, right? So what does it cause the delocalization? Because it means that these pi bonds, it can be readily broken and can be readily formed in another place. So that's why that we have written this sentence, the pi bond of alkenes, all the pi bonds of alkenes, is the pi bond of alkene is localized between identical atoms, right? So if the pi bond is between the first carbon and second carbon, maybe today on 12th August 2022, so even if we come to check the bond, the double bond in alkenes, on 12th August 2023, then we find that the pi bond is still localized at the same position. Are we together?
Yes.
Okay. Again, so another key point, remember that alkenes undergo so many chemical reactions. You have to note this point, very important. Undergo so many chemical reactions. We'll be studying few of them or some of them, but you have to know alkenes is more reactive aliphatic hydrocarbons compared to alkynes, compared to alkane, right? Are we together? So sometimes you can learn maybe three chemical reactions of alkenes and then you say, I have covered alkenes. No, that is not true. There are so many reactions that you possibly have never heard about alkenes.
So you have to make sure that, and I think this is a it's a prerequisite of aromatic hydrocarbons, because most of aromatic hydrocarbons, we can find that they are undergoing this kind of the similar reactions like how these aliphatic hydrocarbons undergo. Are we together? So everything that's written here is very important. Alkenes are more reactive. Alkenes undergo so many reactions, so many chemical reactions. Alkenes have double bonds, that's very important. Double bonds between carbon atoms, where one bond is sigma bond and the second one is what is pi bond. And the reactivity of alkenes depends on what? Reactivity of the pi bond. It does not depend only on the reactivity of the covalent bond. No. It's also the main, means that the part where we find the double bonds, it's a source of so many chemical reactions of alkenes. However, that it can undergo also some other chemical reactions by using some other parts, or maybe by using some covalent bonds with between the two atoms. But the most reactive part is the pi bond. Okay? And then you have to know that the pi bond of alkenes is localized. It's not localized. It's what? Localized. Are we together?
Yes.
Remember that benzene, as benzene, the way that it is, just to give you the overview, benzene, which is actually that it's the heart of aromatic organic compounds, we just write like this one. So these are the carbons. So here we have a single bond, and here we have a double bond. And here we have a single bond. Here we have a double bond. And here we have a single bond. And here we have what? A double bond. So double bonds means what? Alkenes. Right? So this is kind of alkene properties. But these double bonds, but this one, so you see these double bonds will be localizing. For example, that this is the first carbon, second carbon, third carbon, fourth carbon, fifth carbon, sixth carbon. So you see that the double bond at this time is between first carbon and second carbon. But this one can be delocalized. And if it can be delocalized after a short time, you find the double bonds is here and this becomes single bond. Right? Then this one is delocalizing. After a short time, this becomes a single bond and this one becomes a double bond. Then again, that this one delocalizing after a short time, this becomes a single bond and this is a double bond. And that's why for the benzene compounds, or that we say we have, because you have Kekulé structure and you have aromatic structure. So that's why you find that we have this structure. So you have something like this way. And then simply we have a ring structure. Why? Because of delocalization. Right? So this is the example of delocalized pi bond. This is still pi bond. This is pi bond. All of these three are still what? Pi bond. And this pi bond is like the pi bond that we have in what? In alkene. Are we together? This is stuff are not difficult or not complicated. The students are the ones who are complicated. Right? Again, another sentence, as I told you in laboratory preparations of alkenes, all the laboratory preparations or all the chemical reactions that we use to prepare alkenes in laboratories undergo elimination reaction, right? So also, all the chemical reactions of alkenes are treated, or all the chemical reactions of alkenes are classified as electrophilic addition reaction. So we told you about electrophile, we told you about electrophilic additions and nucleophilic addition. Okay? So we say that so alkenes undergo electrophilic Alkene undergo electrophilic addition chemical reaction.
So alkenes undergo electrophilic addition chemical reaction. So what is electrophilic addition reaction? I have told you, refer the previous session, between session one, between session three, electrophilic addition reaction, I think that you have to refer, yes, session 60 and session 7. You can access in our team. You can access also in our official YouTube channel. But I guess that's the first one, that's the time, because we say that the laboratory preparations, the laboratory chemical preparations of alkenes undergo elimination reaction. But that elimination reactions has to follow a particular rule, which is called what? Saito's rule, right? Even the chemical reactions of alkenes undergo a particular rule that in chemistry called Markovnikov's rule, right? Yes. So Markovnikov's rules is the rule that guiding electrophilic addition chemical reactions of what of alkenes. So we say that the electrophilic addition chemical reaction of alkenes follow the Markov follows the Markovnikov's rule. Follows Markovnikov's rule. So before we continue, let us take this Markovnikov's rule. So the fundamental question is, state the Markovnikov's rule. State the Markovnikov's rule. Thank you. So McConaughey's rule states that during electrophilic addition reaction involving asymmetrical, during electrophilic addition reaction involving asymmetrical alkenes, asymmetrical reagent incoming electrophile is added to the most hydrogenated carbon. Carbon atom. At the root. So during electrophilic addition reaction of 40 of alkenes involving asymmetrical alkenes, so let me just underline the keywords. Don't, for you, it means when you are stating this rule, don't underline, but you want to underline the keywords. During electrophilic addition reaction involving asymmetrical alkenes and the asymmetrical reagent, the incoming electrophile is added to the most hydrogenated carbon atom. So you are going to have a most hydrogenated carbon and least hydrogenated carbon. If you do remember that, how can you state the Satis rule? So during elimination reaction, the hydrogen is eliminated from what?
Less hydrogenated carbon.
Less hydrogenated or least hydrogenated carbon. So it is vice versa of 40. So McConaughey's rules is kind of vice versa, but there it is just elimination. But if you want to treat them or compare them on what you are going to deal with, then we can say that it's vice versa of what you've been doing. But also it can state, so let me just read another way that you can state the McConaughey's rule. McConaughey's rules can also state that the asymmetrical reagents, adds to asymmetrical alkene. McConaughey's rule state that when asymmetrical reagent adds to an symmetrical alkene, the electrophile will be attached to the double bonded chemical. Let me repeat. McConaughey's rule states that when a symmetrical reagent adds to an symmetrical alkene, the electrophile will be attached to the double bonded carbon.
only one student who is writing in this physical class, which bears the greatest number of hydrogen. I repeat, McConnell's rules state that when asymmetrical reagents, when asymmetrical reagent adds to asymmetrical alkene, the electrophile will be attached to the double bounded carbon, which bear the greatest number of hydrogen. Let me repeat lastly, McConnell's rules state that when asymmetrical reagent add to asymmetrical alkene, the electrophile will be attached to the double bonded carbon, which bears the greatest number of hydrogen.
Okay, so if that's the case, let now take you into the chemical reaction. So we say that let us start with examples. Examples of electrophilic addition reaction of alkenes. So the following are some examples of electrophilic addition reaction. Electrophilic addition reaction of alkenes. The first one is reactions with hydrogen halide. Reaction of hydrogen halides. Reactions of hydrogen halides are the first chemical reaction that will give us the overview of the electrophilic addition reactions of alkenes. So reactions of hydrogen halides and alkenes. So you can say that in alkenes. So I say that the general, and the good thing are the condition for these reactions is okay, presence of lactic acid. So I say that alkenes undergo electrophilic addition reaction. reaction with hydrogen halides. Under the presence of 40 of Lewis acid, example aluminum chloride.
So alkene react with hydrogen halides under the presence of 40 Lewis acid.
So the general weight chemical equation we have alkene. We have to use hydrogen halides. And then here we have Lewis acid. So the product is alkyl halide because this additional reaction. So these hydrogen halides we are adding in alkenes. Then we say that the general molecular chemical equation it's what? So here you have alkene. Hydrogen halides, and we have Lewis acid. For example, we have aluminum chloride to form for this case. You say that we are going to have halides. Because we say that the incoming electrophile is added to the most hydrogenated carbon. So this is the product. So this is alkenes, functional group of alkenes, where we have double bond. This is the hydrogen halide. This is an example of Lewis acid. And this is the product, which is alkyl halide. So in order to have the general overview of this reaction between alkenes and hydrogen halides, so let us do this question. So yesterday we ended example 5. I'm talking to you. So this is the example 6. So complete the following chemical reaction with mechanism.
aluminium bromide, or how do you call it? It's aluminium bromide. Okay. So for this one, also we have to use this aluminium chloride. So this is your home, right? So you've been given an assignment to complete the following reactions with mechanism, which actually will give you the comprehension of how the reactions take place. So solution. So let us write the open structure for the first chemical reaction. So here we have a double bond, that's why that we have such kind of the limited number of hydrogen. And hence we have also the bond between hydrogen, Xa is independent to it, halogen. So under the presence of 40 of Lewis acid, which is aluminium chloride. Okay. So we have to be careful to see how these additional, the electrophilic additional reactions take place. So remember electrophilic additional reaction. You say that in electrophilic additional reaction, the electrophile is added first to the compound and then followed by the nucleophile. Nucleophilic additional reaction, the nucleophile is added first to the compounds and then followed by what? By electrophiles. Those are the simple definitions should be in your mind. And that's why we taught you in general introductions of 40 of organic chemistry before this stuff, because we know we need them. But some of the students, they used to skip it and say, I'm an expert banner. Electrophilic, electrophilic. This is a simple thing. They don't even appear in a final exam. I know most students used to say that. But we say, okay, there's no problem. This is the alive match. In Swahili, we call it this the mubashara. So this is, we are doing this things mubashara. So we realize whether you are, you had a fact or you have been lost. So in this case, the first bond breaking that will take place is between hydrogen and the halogens. And halogens always, all the halogens are more electronegative more than hydrogen. So the bond is going to break heterolytically and the halogen withdraw all the bonding electrons and make the hydrogens to be more electrophilic. At the first step, so we come into this second state. We have now, we have formulated all the, means that in our reaction, we have two species, or we have anorganic compounds, and then we have two species. The first species, we have electrophile. This is the electrophile, okay? Because electrophile, we say it's a chemical substance which is deficient with electrons, while nucleophile is rich with electrons. And here we have the halogens, which is nucleophile. And then we still have our conditions or our catalyst, which is what is aluminium chloride, which is the Lewis acid, right? Okay. So let us continue. So now we have electrophile and we have a neutrophile. And remember, whenever you are breaking forms, you have to remember the rules that will be applied in chemistry or in organic. We have some rules that we have to follow. Here we have pi bond and sigma bond, as I say previously. So, and then you have to remember McConnell's rule. McConnell's rule states that during electrophilic addition reaction, the incoming electrophile is added to the most hydrogenated carbon atom. So because this is the one of the example of electrophilic addition reaction, say that in electrophilic addition reaction, we add the electrophile first into the organic compound and followed by the neutrophile. Simply the way that you can differentiate electrophile and nucleophile, electrophile is a positively charged atom or compound. And nucleophile, I'm talking to you, Patrice, and then you're watching now. And the nucleophile, it's a negatively charged atom. And the nucleophile means nucleus loving. Electrophile means electron loving. So always positive love electrons. And negative love sorty nucleus. Nucleus we find protons. So negative love positive. Positive love what electrons. Why? Due to the electrostatic principle or electrostatic fundamental law that unlike charge repel and like charge attract each other. So because this is the positive charge and the negative charge are like, so they attract each other, it means they love each other. That's the principle behind atomic physics. So if that's the case, because this is the electrophilic addition reaction, between this carbon and this carbon, which is more hydrogenated? The first one. Between this carbon and this carbon, which is more hydrogenated? How many hydrogens does this carbon have?
One.
How many hydrogens does this carbon have?
Two.
So the carbon with two hydrogens is most hydrogenated compared to the carbon with one hydrogen, or vice versa. Which carbon is more hydrogenated? Because McConnell's rule asks us to identify the most hydrogenated carbon. The most hydrogenated carbon. And that most hydrogenated carbon should be nearby the double bond. So this is the most hydrogenated carbon. So this is the electrophile and this is the neutrophile. So let me just write for those who have forgotten. This is the electrophile. And this is neutrophile. This is the neutrophile. So then, listen carefully. So how this bond is going to break down? So, because, okay, so I think that because I want to use this bond in the bottom there. So this is what this is electrophile. And this is what this is the neutrophile. This is nucleophile. Okay. So if that's the case, so this is the point where the bond has to start because the rule says that if the pi bond undergo electrophilic addition reaction, then the bond will start from here and pass to the carbon which is going to receive the incoming electrophile like this. What does it mean? Here we have pi electrons, and here we have the incoming electrophile. So this is the rule that the bond has to start from the carbon, which is less hydrogenated, and pass nearby the carbon, which is more hydrogenated, where this electrophile will come. Right? Because according to McConnell's rules, during electrophilic addition reaction, the incoming electrophile will be added to the most hydrogenated carbon. So if that's the case, these bonds will break down in this way. This is carbon, or this is the hydrocarbon. Here we have hydrogen, and then you have a single bond. We have this guy,
and then we have this one, and then we have this one. And let's say, before we add the hydrogens, before we add the electrophile, plus what the chlorine, which is nucleophile, right? So listen, so you mean that when this bond breakdowns, this becomes as a nucleophile, and this becomes as electrophile, electrophilic carbon. That's why we say this carbon, this hydrogen, will be added here. Right? So in the case, we say that we have hydrocarbon, we have carbon, we have hydrogen here. So this is partially positive. And here we have a carbon, then we have hydrogen. Then here we have a bond with hydrogen. Then here we have a hydrogen, plus 30, plus X, which is partially negative. And then our condition is still aluminum chloride. Are we together? Are we together?
Yes.
So, because this electrophilic, and we have already added electrophile into the most hydrogenated carbon, so this nucleophile now will be added into this least hydrogenated carbon. Right? So then now we have what? This is the hydrocarbon, we have carbon, we have hydrogen, we have halogen, we have carbon, we have hydrogen, we have hydrogen, we have hydrogen. That's ending. Nothing difficulty, no any miracle, just you have to follow principles and rules of organic chemistry that I've been teaching you from the beginnings of this one. So now, when you finish your overall reaction, because in some of the context, you'll be asked right overall reaction. So you have here what? You have hydrocarbon, then CH, then you have CH2, then you have hydrogen halides, and then some the presence of 40 aluminium chloride. Then we form what? Then we form our C or carbon, then this is X, and then here we have hydrogen, then here we have carbon, we have three hydrogen atoms. And overall reaction. So if now we do the same for CH2, so we have double bond between these two carbons, and here we have hydrogen, and here we have hydrogen with hydrogen, then you have the bond between hydrogen and chlorine, and the presence of what? Aluminium chloride. So the bond first break down in this way. So if you didn't understand well, listen again. I'm repeating the mechanism with this, with the second example. With this second example. So here we have double bond, we still have double bond between carbon and carbon. And here we have single bond, plus what? Hydrogen, which is partially positive, plus what? Chlorine, partially negative. Then here we have what? Aluminium chloride. Okay? Aluminium chloride. So afterward, this is between this carbon, which is more hydrogenated. Most of them, they have the same number of hydrogen. No miracle. This carbon has two hydrogens, this carbon has two hydrogens. So what are you looking for? They have equal number of hydrogens, that's all. None of them switch more hydrogenated. So it means that there are two possibilities. Either the incoming electrophile to attach in this carbon or to attach in this carbon. Right? So any choice is fine. So suppose that you want to come to be attached in this carbon. Suppose means your choice that let us choose the incoming electrophile to attach in this carbon. So it means that this is the starting point, so the bond will go in this way, and then taking this sort of electrophile. Because we, according to the rules, mean that always the arrow will start from the least hydrogenated carbon to the most, or to the, and passing
nearby. The carbon which is going to receive what is incoming, electrified. All of these rules, this way of drawing these arrows, I've taught them in general introductions of organic. Right? Yes. So if you have missed it, you can access all of the contents in our Tambani Online A-Level Circuit School, square bracket on July M, just to go into the playlist of 40 Advanced Organic Chemistry. So after that, so you have hydrogen, you have a bond here, you have one here, you have one here, you have carbon, you have one here, you have hydrogen here. Huh? So then this is what's partially positive. Partially what? Yeah. Okay, yeah, partially positive because this became sort of partially negative. That's why it has received your T, becoming electrified. Plus what? Plus fluorine, which is partially negative. So this is the new profile. And the presence of 40 of aluminium fluoride. Okay, so then this one will be added into this carbon. Okay?
Yes.
So, if that is the case, you have a bond between carbon, hydrogen, here it's hydrogen, here it's carbon, here it is chlorine, here it's hydrogen, here it is hydrogen, that is the order. So overall reaction or chemical reaction. We had a sign, we had a sink, CH2, CH2, and undergo electrophilic additional reactions to hydrogen chloride under the presence of aluminium chloride. Then the product is CH3, CH2, chlorine. Right?
Yes.
So that is how electrophilic addition of alkenes with hydrogen halides takes place. The second example of electrophilic additions of alkenes is a chemical reaction that we call it a reaction between alkenes and bromine water. So chemical reaction between alkenes and what is bromine and bromine water. So chemical reaction between alkenes and bromine water. Say bromine water.
Bromine water.
So when you say bromine water, we mean bromine water. So alkenes reacting with bromine water. Bromine water, when we say bromine water, it means we have bromine slash water. Okay, bromine water to form two possible products. Form two possible products, which are vicinal compound, and the bromoalkanol product, bromoalkanol product. So alkene can undergo electrophilic addition with bromine, water. Alkenes can undergo, alkenes react with bromine water, to form two possible products. Which are vicinal compound and bromoalkanol product. So, you know, I told you about vicinal compound in session 19. So, let me just see the functional group of what? Of bromoalkanol, which is a new bromoalkanol. It's a new compound for you, alkanol product or bromoalkanol compound. It is one. You have maybe hydrocarbons, here you have bromine, and then here you have carbon, and here you have alcohol group. So here you can have hydrogen, here you can have hydrogen, here you can have hydrogen. So this is the compound you call the bromoalkanol compound. Bromoalkanol compound. So this means that we have bromine and the alcohol group in adjacent carbons. Okay?
Yes.
So generally, where the chemical equation. So here we are getting to what our friend Francis have said about formations of major product and minor product. This is the place where I can find it. So we have alkenes on the reactant side, plus what? Plus bromine water. And this reaction can produce either of the two products. It can be vicinal compound. Or it can be what? Bromoalkanol compound. So we have this in a compound. There's this in a compound. We have bromoalkanol compound. So alkenes plus bromine water, we have this in a compound, bromoalkanol compound. So in general, molecular chemical equation that this is alkene. That's bromine water.
construction of roof for the Visno compound. Say that this is Romani. We've carbon here. So this is Visno compound. Or said reaction can produce a bromo alkanol. Is this example 7?
Yes.
So complete the following chemical reactions with mechanism. Okay, so complete the following chemical reactions with mechanism. We have the functional group of alkyne. I react in bromine water. And then I have also methyl butene. 2Na. React in bromine water. Also, we have what? We have 2,3 dimethyl. 3,4 dimethyl hex 3N. Reacting with what is bromine water. Solution.
What is the second compound?
Pardon?
Can you name it?
No, why should I name it? It's your hormone. What are you doing if I name it for you?
Is it a di-NO?
Di-NO?
Yeah.
Okay, so solution for Roman 1. So we have hydrocarbon. We have CH. We have CH2. Plus what? Bromine water. So I would like to ask you to stop writing and listen the mechanism that you are going to follow to form both products. Then I will tell you that between the two products, which product is major product and which product is minor product. Okay, are you together?
Yes.
Okay, so we have this one. So this is it's the electrophilic addition reaction. So solution, stop writing as I said, write the open structure. This is aliphatic, or this is hydrocarbon. We have a bond between carbon and this one. Here we have a bond between carbon and hydrogen. Here you have a bond between carbon and carbon. Here you have a bond between carbon and hydrogen. And you have a bond between carbon and hydrogen. Last word. So here we have bromine. We have a bond between bromine and bromine. But also we have water as nucleophile due to its lone pair in oxygen atom. So the first step, we say that the bond between, remember this electrophilic additional reaction, you have to remember, because that's the cornerstone, that is the foundations or the fundamental concept for this reaction. So the reaction is the electrophilic additional reaction. So additional reaction, we are adding a substance into the chemical or into the organic compound. So you should have something first to add, right? Don't think, where am I going to add? First of all, we should have what you are going to add into the organic compound, right? That's the first step. So the first step, this bond will be breakdown. So usually, we know that if you have a bond between maybe chlorine and chlorine or fluorine and fluorine, when the bond will undergo homolytic cleavage, will form free radical, right? But it depends the conditions and it depends the environment of the reaction. For this case, mean that bromine, because of the presence of water, bromine will be forced to undergo homolytic cleavage rather than heterolytic cleavage. What the means of homolytic cleavage? It means that the each bonding atoms will leave its contributed electrons. What the means of heterolytic cleavage? One atom in a covalent bond will leave with two bounded, with two shared electrons. So for that case, however, that the electronegativity between bromine and bromine is the same, but under this condition, the electronegativity, okay, so there's a, it means that this bond will be forced to break heterolytically. How? It means that if this bond will break, this bromine will withdraw all the bonding electrons, and this will become partially negative, this is partially positive. It's only possible for these reactions and even some other organic reactions. So you have to understand in that case. Don't claim that when the bond between chlorine and chlorine breakdowns is only forming free radical. Or when the bond between bromine and bromine breakdowns is only forming free radical. Don't claim that. It depends under what condition. Because for the bond to break homolytically or heterolytically, sometimes does not depend on electronegativity. But depends the condition. Sometimes the compounds can be forced to, or a molecule can be forced to undergo and drastically bonding cleavage rather than the one we have expected. Are we together?
Yes.
Okay. So if that's the case, now we create, because if you break this one homolytical and forming free radical, you have already deviated from McConnell's rule, because McConnell's rule is guiding only electrophilic addition reaction. Right? Are we together?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have aliphatic hydrocarbons, and here we have a bond. We did not do anything with our pi bond. Okay, so you have a bond with this hydrogen, with this hydrogen. Then here, here plus. So for this case, you have bromine, and this bromine is partially negative, plus another bromine. This bromine is partially positive, and at the presence of 40, presence of water molecule. Okay, so now we have electrophile, we have neutrophile. Electrophile is loving what? Electrons. Nucleophile is loving what? Protons, which are a nucleus of an atom. Right?
Yes.
So if that's the case, we want now to bring them, we want to add electrophile into our organic, into our alkenes. So to add electrophile, between this carbon and this carbon, which is more hydrogenated? Between the first carbon and second carbon, which is more hydrogenated?
The second.
The second. According to McConnell's rules, which one should receive the incoming electrophile?
The second.
The most hydrogenated, right?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
So, and then according the rules of breaking the bonds, means that the arrow will start from here and passing nearby. The carbon which you receive the incoming what? Electrophile. Your son, you are sleeping. So then we have this one. We have so many problems today, including sleeping. So this is a hydrogen. So the bond will break. The way it is going to break, this will become more nucleophile, and this is this nucleophilic carbon, electrophilic carbon, which you call the carbonium atom after a short time. So this is electrophilic, partially positive, and here we have a bond. So here we have a bond with two carbon and hydrogen. This is partially negative, and then this is what? So we still have what? Bromine. Okay, so bromine, so it means that right now our bromine electrophile will be attached here. Right? Right? Uh-huh. So then here we have bromine as our nucleophile. And then, so the presence of watching of water. So we say that there is, we can form two compounds. We can form either vicinal compounds, or we can form what? Bromalkanol compounds. So let us form the vicinal compound first, and then I will teach you how we can form bromalkanol compound. Okay?
Yes.
So if that's the case, we come to this place. Then we say that. Mm-hmm. So this one now is reacting with this compound. So the nucleophile means, because this is the carbonium ion now, before water, because water also is a nucleophile. So for that case, you're sure you are sleeping. For that case, you have this bond between carbon and hydrocarbons. This is hydrogen, this is bromine, and this is carbon, this is hydrogen, this is hydrogen, this is bromine. Okay? And then you say that this is the final product. The vicinal compound. So this is vicinal Vishnoji, Vishnokantam.
Okay?
Yes.
So that is in case of Vishnokantam. So, second stage, we say that formation of what? Formation of Brahma. Brahma alkanol. So to form Brahma alkanol compounds, we just have to start from the second stage, or from this stage. We have aliphatic hydrocarbons, we have carbon here, we have hydrogen, we have partially positive before it has received the incoming nucleophile, and then we have carbon, we have hydrogen here, we have hydrogen here, and the bromine here. And then this one, here we have bromine as nucleophile, and then in the presence of water, like this, like this. So this is nucleophile, and this is nucleophile. So to form bromalkanol, before bromine is added into carbonium ion, remember that this we call it carbonium, carbonium ion. Okay?
Yes.
So before bromine is added into the electrophilic carbons, then water will be added into electrophilic carbons. So this is aliphatic hydrocarbons, that hydrocarbons. Here we have carbon bonds with hydrogen. This is partially positive. And here we have carbon. And here we have hydrogen. And here we have hydrogen. And here we have bromine. Then plus what? Then plus bromine. Okay? Plus bromine as partially negative or in presence of nucleophile. So this nucleophile will be added into the carbonium ion. So if that's the case, we have aliphatic hydrocarbons, we have carbon, we have hydrogen here, and then this is the non-pair, it's the one which is going to form a bond with carbon. There's a sharing of electrons between oxygen and carbon. But that oxygen has been bonded with hydrogen, like this. Are we together?
Yeah.
Are we together?
Yes.
I said stop writing. I still see somebody in this class still copying. So this is hydrogen. This is bond with bromine. Okay?
Yes.
So oxygen is overloaded. Oxygen cannot form three bonds. It's only ability to form two covalent bonds. Right?
Yeah.
So what's going to happen here? So here we still have bromine as nucleophile. So the bond will break between oxygen and hydrogen because we formed a new bond between carbon and oxygen, so we cannot break it. We may either break the bond between hydrogen and oxygen or this oxygen and hydrogen. So you have a choice whether to break this bond or this bond because they have the same properties. Okay?
Yes.
So suppose that we break this bond. So between carbon and the hydrogen, between oxygen and the hydrogen, oxygen is more electronegative, so it will withdraw all the bonding electrons. So this will become partially negative, which is meaningless, but this guy will become partially positive, which is meaningful, because it loses electrons. Right? So in that case, we have what? So this is our bromalkanol. So you have the bond between carbon and the hydrogen. And here we have what? Hydroxide, oxygen bond between carbon and oxygen and hydrogen. And then she say what? You say you have a bond with carbon, with hydrogen. And then here we have bond with bromine, plus what? Plus hydrogen, partially positive, plus bromine, partially negative. So, this one will donate electrons to hydrogen from hydrogen bromide. So you can see that now we achieve our goal. So you achieve the goal now that you have Anna, then we have
what? Hydroxide. And then here we have what? Hydrogen. And then here we have what? CH. We have what? Two hydrogen atoms. But here we have bromine. Plus what? Plus hydrogen bromide. So, overall, reaction. This is still alkenes. We didn't get into some other organic compound. It's still alkene.
Yes.
So here we have our reactants. So you say that can react to certain bromine water. And we say we can form two products. The first one we can form Ara, CH, hydroxide, CH2, bromine. We can also form Ara, CH, bromine, CH, bromine. So this is what? Bromo,
alkanol
compound,
bromoethanol.
And then this, where is the summer? Do you notice what does it represent? And this one is what? This is no
compound.
So then from there, somebody is still writing. Which is major product between bromo alkanol and the this compound? But the question we have, okay, so that's the question we have. So, have you finished the copy? Okay, stop. Please copy quickly. I want to continue. Okay, so we have a question here, which is a major product between bromoalkanol compound and bisphenol compound. So the answer of this question is, and if I want just to give you the warning, don't claim that all the electrophilic additional reactions of 40 of alkenes form major and minor product. Don't claim that. Some of them they form major and minor product, and some of the chemical reactions they form only single product. So you should not find, I know many students, they want to find a general way of learning and keeping information. But all McCormick's rules guiding on formations of major and minor product, no. Okay. So in this reaction, we say that the major product is bromoalkanol compound. Why? Because you see the mechanisms of these reactions, how does it take place. In this stage, you see that the bromine breakdowns to form electrophile and nucleophile. At this stage, so let's say that this is the first stage, this is the second stage, and then here we are. So after second stage, before this arrow, so before this bromine is added at this stage, so we have bromocarbonium ion, and also we have bromine as electrophile nucleophile, and we have also water as nucleophile. So for this, at this stage, we have two chances, as we say. A, the bromine, the nucleophile will be added into this electrophilic carbon, right? Or bromine or water molecule will be added into this electrophilic carbon. Okay? So you might have either this possibility or this possibility. So practically or experimentally, this one is favored more than this one.
Why? Because water is present in excess more than bromine. That's why water will be added into this bromocarbonium ion to form bromoating alkanol compound. Are we together? So this is a major product, this is a minor product. And the only difference is not in electrophilic part, it's in the aortic nucleophilic part. Because this is the nucleophile, this is the nucleophile. So this nucleophile will be added quickly and easily, more than additions of 40 bromine ion due to availability of water in excess. Are we together? So Roman 2 and Roman 3, I have a homework. So this is again additional for homework went. So it means that Roman 2 and Roman 3 are your homework. Of example 7, something like example 7, so I'm not mistaken. So bromo alkanol compound the major product. It's a major product because bromine is slightly soluble, in water. So bromine ion and water as nucleophile competes. How do they compete? Competes. Competition. So bromine and water bromine and water molecules compete competitions. I want just write the verb of competition.
Correct.
Is this correct?
Compete.
Not helping you to get the blood molecules undergo competitions to form new bond with carbonium. Carbonium ion, and water wins the competition. Competition to form bromo alkanol compound. So water will compete in such competition. From what? From alkanol carbon. Have another question. This is Homer. How can you distinguish alkenes? Of other organic compounds. How can you distinguish alkenes from a mixture of other organic compounds? So before I end this session 20, let us finish with one reactions, which is called the reactions between alkenes and the concentrated sulfuric acid. Chemical reaction. Chemical reactions chemical reactions between alkenes and the concentrated sulfuric acid. So another example of electrophilic additional reactions of alkenes is when alkenes react with concentrated sulfuric acid. So alkenes undergo electrophilic addition reaction with concentrated sulfuric acid. Concentrated sulfuric acid to form alkan hydrogen alkan hydrogen sulfate form alkan hydrogen sulfate. Which appear as white
precipitate, which appear as white precipitate. So argon hydrogen sulfate appear with, as white or tea precipitate, and this is very important compound in organic chemistry. So the general word chemical equation, general word chemical equation, the general word chemical equation is alkenes react with conical sulfuric acid and form what? Alkane hydrogen sulfate. Form alkane hydrogen sulfate. Francis, are you there?
Mm-hmm. Huh? What's going on in your mind? Something going on in your mind?
Nothing. So your mind is free. It's not working. Okay. So alkenes react with concentrated sulfuric acid and form alkane hydrogen sulfate. So the functional group of alkene, we may say this one, and then react with conical sulfuric acid. And the product is this one, argon. So you have a bond with oxygen here, and this bond of oxygen. Then we have bond with sulfur trioxide like this. Here we still have our hydrogen. Here we have three hydrogen substitutions. So this is the product. So this is what you call alkane hydrogen sulfate. Say alkane hydrogen sulfate.
Alkane hydrogen sulfate.
So this is alkane. Why? Because there is single bond between carbon atom. That's why it is called alkane. Right?
Yeah.
But this alkane, it has a tertiary group or substituent group, which is called what? Hydrogen sulfate. Listen. This is not a sulfuric acid. It is hydrogen sulfate. This is sulfate because sulfate always has four oxygen. Four oxygen. These are four, three oxygen plus one oxygen. Make what? Four oxygen. With one sulfur, make something called the sulfate. Right? But sulfuric acid, we need two hydrogen. Here you have only one hydrogen. So that's why you call it the hydrogen sulfate. It's not a sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid here, we have two hydrogens, one atom of sulfur and four atoms of oxygen. In hydrogen sulfate, we have one hydrogen, we have four atoms of oxygen and one atom of 40 of sulfur. So you have to differentiate and you have to understand inorganic and organic compounds. Are we together?
Yes.
Okay. So if that's the case, now let us work on this business. Then we change the file or we call the day. This is example 8 or 9? Is example 8 or 9?
9.
9. Okay. Complete it. So remember that
The responsibility means the task of completing the reactions with mechanisms sometimes is a favor, but just to give you comprehension, so understanding, completing with the mechanism, the following chemical reactions. Following chemical reactions. So the first one is the general, and I told you that I prefer to do the mechanism for the general chemical reaction, so to simplify mechanism for all other examples of organic compounds. CH3, CH, CH, CH2, CH2, CH3. Sometimes in some of the reactions you can see that the concos are finished. So remember that this is your homework. So remember to do all the homeworks that I have left for you before the next session in order for you to try. Okay, so you can stop writing and listen carefully. So we have the functional group of alkenes. And then, undergo chemical reaction with concos sulfuric acid. So write the open scratch. Sulfur, it can form bonds by using 6 electrons. Means it can form covalency bond by using 6 electrons. So I'll later write the open structure of sulfuric acid. How many hydrogen atoms do you have? How many oxygen atoms do you have? 4. So all of these hydrogens, the simple atom is sulfur. So hydrogens and oxygen atoms, they have to bond to the sulfur, right? And this you see the power of hybridization, because sulfur has to undergo hybridizations in order for it to have a capacity of forming 6 covalent bonds. So sulfur bonds with oxygen, forming double bonds with oxygen, and then forming a double bond with another oxygen atom. So now we have a bond between sulfur and 2 oxygen atoms, and then sulfur forms a bond between oxygen and hydrogen, meaning that this oxygen has to bond with hydrogen, and then sulfur bonds with oxygen like this. So you can see sulfur has how many covalent bonds? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Single bond. Oxygen is an octet state. Oxygen, double bond. Oxygen, double bond. So every atom has reached its octet state. Okay?
Yes.
So after having this, remember that this is still electrophilic reaction. Electrophilic additional reaction. Okay, so electrophilic additional reaction. Okay, so after having this open structure now, you can understand, remember, whatever you are doing, This is the electrophilic addition of reaction. So we need electrophile to add into the organic compound. Okay? That should be in your mind. So then, you have to think about, we have six bonds there. We have eight bonds in sulfuric acid. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Right? So which one should we break down? And then we have to break it down logically. Right? So the only possibility here to form, because we have oxygen, we have three atoms in sulfuric acid, oxygen, sulfur, and hydrogen. The less electronegative, which can be acting as electrophile, is hydrogen only. It's less electronegative, more than sulfur and oxygen. So the less electronegative atoms, always it can become electrophile. It can be just have some properties with the metals, because metals are less electronegative compared to non-metals. Right? That should be in your mind. So for that case, these bonds break down homolytically. Heterolytical. Okay? Okay?
Yes.
So the bonds break homolytically like this. So this bond break homolytically, we have this guy. So here we have a double bond, we have a single bond with hydrogen, and then plus what? Oxygen, double bond with sulfur, then single bond with oxygen, hydrogen, and then here we have what? So you have a single bond with oxygen, and then you have triple double bond with oxygen plus what? Plus hydrogen as partially positive. So this become what? Nucleophile, this become what? Electrophile. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, there's one missing hydrogen. You're saying yes, because you don't concentrate. So between this carbon, which is more hydrogenated, this one. So the incoming electrophile will be attached here, right? Then I told you the R will be starting here and passing nearby the carbon, which is more hydrogenated, to receive the incoming electrophile. Okay?
Yeah.
Nothing is difficult. So then you have the bonds with this guy, you have hydrogen, now you have electrophilic hydrogen, which has been added, and here you have a single bond. So don't add the hydrogens and then you still have double bond. Because carbons now will be overloaded with bonds. So here we have a bond, here we have a bond. Here you have what? Partially negative. Then plus what? Plus oxygen, double bond. Double bond with what? With sulfur. Then here it is, hydroxide. And this one is oxygen, partially negative. This is double bond with oxygen like this. Okay? So this is the nucleophile now. So we add a nucleophile. No. This hydrogen should come here.
Yes.
So this has been a nucleophile, and this carbon is electrophile. Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Remember that he always, a electrophile comes to the nucleophilic carbon. Right? So this is nucleophilic carbon, this is the electrophilic carbon. So this is the electrophilic carbon. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. So now we have added electrophile, we are going to add what? A nucleophile. So this guy will be added here. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
So here you have alkyl group. We have carbon, we have hydrogen, we have carbon, we have hydrogen, we have hydrogen, we have hydrogen, and here we have a bond between carbon and oxygen, but this oxygen has what? Bond with sulfur, sulfur is double bond with oxygen, and also it has double bond with what? It's another oxygen, but it has a single bond with hydroxide, is oxygen and hydrogen. Are we together? So this is what you got, alkan, hydrogen. Alkan, hydrogen.
Sulfate.
So even this one is your homework now, because
course you have understood the principle and the wishing that everything you have there will be a part of our guarantee. Come. So overall, chemical reaction. Overall chemical reaction, we have our planet. N plus what? Concosulfuric acid. Forms what? So this is CH3, and here we have oxygen, as I say, sulfur trioxide. That's why we write in this way. To illustrate, you have a bond between carbon and oxygen, and you have a bond between oxygen and sulfur. Okay? So this is what you call dirty alkan, hydrogen, sulfate. Alkan, hydrogen, sulfate. So this is the end of session 20, but I ask you and I insist you to do all the homework, especially the homework of how can you distinguish alkenes from what, from the mixture of other organic compounds. Very important question, because I will do correction in session 21 before we continue as examples of electrophilic addition reaction. We still have two examples. We still have two examples, and then we see deviation from McGonigal's rule. We see other reactions of alkenes. Alkenes, it doesn't mean that alkenes only undergo electrophilic additional reactions, but alkenes also undergo oxidation, undergo some other types of chemical reactions. So, my dear students, this is the end of session 20. I invite you in session 21. You have to make sure that you don't miss it. Go through this session. Make sure that you do the homework and make sure that you answer all the questions. You try your level best. Use the comment sections to give me the feedback whether you've understood or it. Or just ask any questions at the point that you didn't understand anything else in order for me to help you as well as I can. So until we meet in the next session, you have to make sure that you enjoy these contents and you go through it slowly. In case you find that these materials are a little bit advanced in your level of understanding, don't hesitate yourself to watch this video several times. Watch it twice, three times, four times, five times, until this information is written in your mind. Before I end these sessions, I would like just to give you a few announcements that will make you a serious or a well-advanced secondary student. In case you feel from your heart that you want to offer our living God your free thanksgiving in order to be a part of this program, or in order to just, yes, to be a part of this program, then you are warmly welcome to offer your freely thanksgiving of any amount, maybe 100 Tanzania shillings, 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, whatever, the any amounts of maybe freely thanksgiving that you feel from your heart, because this program is expensive. We are trying to administer more from analog system or analog teaching system to the digital teaching system, where we can impact millions of the students of present and future generation. So, just it, don't hesitate yourself. You may send it through this telephone number 0759-745331. And your freely thanksgiving will be received and to be used effectively to pay for the running cost of this program, because we still have so many videos that will be coming online and will be publishing in order to help all the advanced secondary students in the United Republic of Tanzania, in African continents, and worldwide. So, feel helpful or feel joyful when you offer your free thanksgiving, because that's what it can make you to get something or to receive reward from our mighty God. So as well as we have begun these sessions and really we have seen the hand of God, I would like just to spend 1 minute to give God thanks for this session. And then it will be the end of this session, and I will ask you to join me in the next session.
So let us pray. Our Father who is in heaven, we say thank you for this opportunity. Thank you because you have been faithful in this session. Thank you because there is no God like you. And thank you because you have opened the mind of the students who are physically here locally and nationally and internationally. Father, we thank you for teaching us about electrophilic addition reactions of organic of alkenes. Father, we ask you to keep on teaching us and reminding us and even teach beyond of what I've told them, Father. Father, we welcome you in the next session where we are praying it right now, which will be the session 21, Our Father, when we'll be continuing and learning, understanding, and applying the knowledge of chemical reactions of alkenes. We give you all the glory for everything that has been done in this place and even in online, in air, in the atmosphere. In Jesus' name, amen. So may God bless you until we meet in the next session. This is Equal July from Tanzania. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all the foreigners. This is the national flag of our country. You're only welcome to enjoy beautiful people and excellent environment for the health of the human being. See you in the next session. Ooh, we're buried in Tanzania.